I think this is the inevitable result of being the last presentation on the last day, so.
We have an energy on it.
Okay, so the reason I'm doing this is because I'm from an analytics background and I'm very passionate about the application of analytics in functions that are not traditionally using them. So if you think about finance, if you think about banks, if you think about retail, the connection is fairly obvious, and a lot of innovation and a lot of stuff around analytics happens in those areas. But where I think analytics can be of immense value is human resources, and that's the topic of my talk today. So just before that, so I represent Bridge Eye to Eye. This is a startup that we started about a year ago, because we are our sole mission in life is to embed data-driven decision making as a practice within organizations, embed within their DNA, so that it becomes as important as having a HR team or having a finance team. So that is precisely what we're working towards, and we think because if that becomes a practice, then the amount of business outcomes that can be gained and doing things better can improve by an order of magnitude. So that's where I'm from. So if you think about, so startups don't have this problem because you know everybody pretty intimately. But I think most startups want to one day become large organizations, because that's the dream that you have when you do a startup. When I will also become 100 million, 1 billion organization, having thousands of employees, I'll be the next Facebook, next Microsoft. So the thing is, there's one thing common across large companies is we have a lot of people. And when you have a lot of people, all of them say that people are their most important assets, which is true. But when there's too much of it, it's an art in itself to kind of manage it. So, and I've seen this across service organizations in India, which typically have thousands of people, where the pressure on the HR team to hire is so immense that they basically whoever comes and applies, they are very glad that somebody applied and they get them in. So the problem is of quantity, but the even bigger problem is of quality. And they simply don't have the time to focus on the quality problem, which is, am I hiring the right profile for the job? Am I even thinking about where this guy is from? Am I even thinking about what job am I hiring for? Is the first problem. So the second problem is typical of large organizations. Nobody thinks that they're paid enough. The organizations think that they're paying you more than what you deserve. And therefore, how do you reconcile this problem? Because you have so much of money that you need to give, and that's always fixed. And then you have a lot of ways by which you need to divide up that money, and you get totally confused on what anchor should I go by in terms of dividing this money. And it's a huge problem. From what I've seen, it is like there are so many variables at play that most HR folks either just give up and say, it's like everybody just grab what you want, or they go by one dimension totally ignoring the other dimensions. The third is, of course, the obvious problem, which is, how do I keep people back? Because most organizations fail because critical people leave them, and therefore it's a huge lift in their performance if they're able to keep good people back. So that is the third, and these three things pretty much would keep most HR managers, this is what they think about all the time. So I don't think there's anything else that really captures their imagination more than these three. So if you think about what is HR analytics, it's nothing great. You don't have to invest in a lot of stuff. It is just a decision that you will use whatever data that you're already capturing. You're capturing because there is a organizational requirement to do so. Your parent in the headquarters told you that these data has to be captured, or the government requires you to capture such data. you have the data with you. It is just a decision to use that data to take people-related decisions. It's as simple as that. So HR analytics means I will use the data that I already have to take better decisions. And second is basically realizing that most problems that seem really difficult to solve, seem really intractable, actually can be solved, can be addressed to a large extent if you just look at the data that you have. So let me go to the first problem, which is the hiring effectiveness problem. So these are from assignments that that we have done in BridgeIQS. I'm just, within 30 minutes, I'm just presenting an overall view of how we went about solving the problem. It doesn't need, unlike other sessions where I sat down, it doesn't need Python, it doesn't need Hadoop, it doesn't need anything, it just needs, because it's for people who are usually in the HR profession, or you know, leaders who are worried about their people, who can do this pretty easily with very rudimentary tools. So the first one is the fitment conundrum, which is, I have roles that I need to fill in my organization. What are the things that I consider when people apply? They have a certain qualification, they are from a certain college or an institution, and location could be two things. Location could be where they are from, location could be which location you're hiring for. So these are typically things that that are attributes that you consider for filling the job role, right? Now, and these are typically things that you have data on when you're filling these job roles. Now, the point I'm making is, if you, when you've done this hiring, if you captured this data on which job role I'll fill with what kind of people, that is enough to kind of solve this problem. Because after that, once these people come into your organization, they start a journey in your organization, right? So there are things that are positive variables, things that they're supposed to do, which is you expect them to stay for a longer while, because once you train them, they have to contribute back something, and if they leave before that, it's a loss. The second is, the rating is another measure of how good they are. Third is, how fast they get promoted is a fairly good indicator of what kind of leadership potential you have hired. Against that are the cost variables, which is the money that you're paying them, attrition, which is how fast they leave, and all the other things that you do to keep them in. Now, all you have to do is, if you have this mapping done, in terms of which role did I fill for which kind of profile, you fill it up the matrix, and then you kind of track these variables individually for each person, you can pretty easily quantify these, because if you look at these variables, all of them are pretty quantifiable. Promotion, you can quantify them as an average promotion rate, which is during their tenure, how many times they got promoted in how many years. Or another variable that will help is time for first promotion, which is, after I hired them, how long did it take for me to promote them? It's a good indicator of how good they are because of the background that they came in. Because once, as they spend more and more time in the organization's variables itself starts affecting them positively and negatively. So because they walk into a good organization, they might become better inside your organization, but that's not the problem you're trying to solve for hiring effectiveness. So time for first promotion is a good indicator for how good they were when they came in. And if you kind of set it up against the cost that I paid them, or you know, all the things, how long were they available before they left, or in which qualification group or an institution group did I see attrition most, it's pretty simple to then construct a very effective data-driven hiring effectiveness engine. It's as simple as this. That's it. You just combine these metrics to form a score. Obviously, you have to set off the positives against the negatives. You can do it however you want. That is why you have weightage. Some organizations value the cost more, the money more. Some organizations value the tenure more. Some organizations value the rating more. So you can give weightages as you feel like. And then a good way of normalizing them is you can use what's called a Z score, or an average dispersion around a mean. So because what happens is, Not all of them are comparable. So tenure could range from 2 to 7 years, whereas salaries could range from 2 lakhs to, you know, 20 lakhs. So they are not comparable as units, and therefore you should normalize them in some way. A very effective, easy way of normalizing them is using what's called the Z-score, an average dispersion around its own average mean. And you apply the weightages and then you're done. So you use this, you can pretty much know for which role, which kind of background works, and that's it. So then you can see that the kind of people that you're seeing that you've hired for the role, you can save money. At the same time, you can also increase the positive variables and minimize the negative variables. The second one is the compensation problem, which is how much do I pay? Now, as I said, how much do I pay has got various elements inside that. Most large organizations are not complete meritocracies, nor are they complete socialist republics. There is a good measure of both. There are obviously goals that you start with. You're supposed to, you know, achieve these goals before you are ready for getting that much amount of increment or whatever. I'm talking about increment because an initial salary is pretty easy to scope. Most organizations think of how much you got before, where are you from, and they use a like grid, and that's fairly easy. The trouble is, how much do I give as an increment from a certain pool that I have? So there's goals, and those goals are twofold. The business itself has a goal which determines the pool that the business gets, as well as the individual has his own performance, which is given by the rating, and these two can be against each other. Business could have done badly, the individual could have done well, and that's where it gets interesting. Then you have tolerance by goal type. So there are some goals on which you might not brook any slacking. There may be other goals which you would understand if an employee doesn't do well, and therefore it's important to measure the tolerance that you're willing to live with against each goal. And like I said, there's a performance rating, which is the employee's performance rating. And then you have the differentiation philosophy, which is some organizations believe that the best performer should get far higher than the average. Some organizations believe that it's like a linear scale, and some organizations believe that there should be no differentiation. So this can very easily be coded in terms of when you combine all of these performances into a score, these can be very easily numerically coded. So, for example, differentiation philosophy, you can either say a red gets 0 average performance, which is an orange gets 10, and a green, which is a great performance, gets 20, or you can say it's 0, 50, and 100, or you can say it's 0, 10, and 100. So it depends on how you want to differentiate. So as long as you do that, you can very easily code or numerically derive and combine the performance against goals, both for the company as well for the individual. Then you have the budget, where again the constraints are typically whatever you've done or you've not done, the business, the amount of money available to the business to disperse as increment is pretty fixed, and that can't change. And of course, then you have typically a direction from the larger organization saying, no matter how bad a business does, you should not give less than a 3% increment. Or however well you do, you should not give anybody more than 12-13%. So such allowable spreads are always there. And then finally, against all this is the problem of how do I make sure that people that I have to keep are satisfied. I have a certain brand image in the market as far as salary is concerned. I usually, you know, target to be at 15th percentile, I usually target to be at 75th percentile of market, etc., etc. So that is another consideration. So typically what happens is in most organizations, they would kind of sacrifice or downplay one against what they want to go after. So my point being that if you take the time and energy to code them upfront in terms of numbers, And if you combine them numerically, then you don't need to do anything like that. Because all you have to do is you put all of these inputs, and Excel has a solver engine. into which you can put the constraints, saying, you know, whatever happens, the money should not increase so much. Whatever happens, somebody should not get so and so. And then you can also have constraints around, I need to have top performers of a certain proportion, average performers of a certain proportion, bottom performers should not get anything. All these constraints can be input, and then you can pretty easily solve this problem. And I'm surprised as to why organizations don't do this. They kind of, in the HR function especially, they pretty much go along one dimension, kind of sacrificing the other dimension. So this is very easily done using solver, provided you do the upfront work to measure or capture all of these things in a numerical way. Because typically what happens is, in the end, if somebody is done not well, they will say, I don't have the data regarding codes, or I don't know where the file went, or it's all in PowerPoint, it can't be coded now in even Excel. So you have to design to set it up, capture them numerically, have them have the tolerances agreed, and then it's, after that, the biggest advantage of this is, at least in the organization that we implemented, is you can give this as a guidance to the supervisor, who is sometimes, if you have large teams, if I'm having a team of say 35 people, I'm sometimes confused about what I should do about some individuals, because some individuals stand out in your mind. You know that they are either very good or very bad. The others, you are at a loss as to what should I do with them. And then this recency effect, and then, you know, whether I like their face or whether, you know, they are related to my wife, things start happening. So this is pretty easily defendable. You can say, this is why I did what I did for you. And therefore, there is no, the scope for argument is reduced significantly. Their argument will obviously be there, because if I have to understand something which is bad for me, I will refuse to understand it. So that is always going to be there. But from the organization standpoint, you can pretty easily defend your decision, and you can give this as a guidance for the supervisor. The last mile, they can do some tweaks. They can say, you know, I know that this guy is in deep trouble, he's been with us for 7 years, I want to give him some more money. All that you can allow. But to start with, if you have an institutionalized system that is data driven in its very design, it is very, very easy to allocate a large sum of money over a huge number of people. The third is the whole question of trying to understand why people are leaving an organization, right? So, and I think the problem is as old as HR itself, where you try to understand why people are leaving. So typically the problem looks like this, which is, shit, everybody seems to be leaving here. I mean, I don't know why they're leaving, but generally everybody is leaving here. Or you would have a hypothesis that I would have formed in your mind, saying, oh, they're leaving because we are not paying them enough. Or they're leaving because some competitor who was working for me has gone and started another company, and he's attracting my team. So your gut feel and your emotions would drive your reasoning behind why everybody's leaving, and then the scope for taking knee-jerk reactions increases. The problem with knee-jerk reactions in attrition is it tends to exacerbate the problem. The more you employ knee-jerk reactions, the more people will leave. So you will catch 5 people and say, I want to keep you back, here's money, don't tell anybody. Obviously, all the other people would know, and then the 5 other people who you didn't catch will leave. Otherwise, they would not have left, right? So what, in the work that we did, it's very simple again. I mean, all the things that I do are pretty simple. And basically, all you have to do is cut the data by various dimensions. The dimensions could be tenure, dimensions could be designation, the dimensions could be location, the dimensions could be work stream, the dimensions could be qualification. Any dimension that you have data on, cut the data using the dimension to then study the attrition problem. In 99 cases out of 100, you will feel that not everybody is leaving. Everybody is obviously not leaving. What is happening is that problem is pretty much present in some dimension. So you will have here where it's at average. I mean, this is either something that's happening at average or something that is not too important. Here, this is one segment where you would find that nobody's leaving, they're pretty happy on this dimension. There's one group which is leaving in a pretty high proportion compared to the overall average, And this could be, typically it could be people who are, you know, analysts who are at the lowest level, or it could be people who are, you know, not getting promoted, anything like that. Any dimension that you capture would have, and it will pretty much be a picture like this. Now what you need to do is, once here, it's easy to come to the conclusion that, okay, yes, all of these people are a problem, we need to take at this, we need to solve this problem for them. But that's usually not the case. The story is usually a little more nuanced, where the minute you find that there is a certain segment having a bigger attrition proportion than the rest of the population, you need to drill down into that segment. What you need to do is you need to cut that block into other variables that you can split them into. For example, if this illustration is, I've just first cut them by the rating that they've received, and you'll see that the bottom performers obviously are leaving, and it's a good thing, because I want people who are not performing well to leave. The average people are staying. The people who have rated a little less than the topmost rating are also staying, which is a good thing. But most alarming is the people who I rate the best are leaving in a huge proportion. So that, among these four, this is where my biggest problem is. So then if you cut that using other variables, like among the people I have given higher rating, if I cut them into compensation quartiles, what do I see? You see that people who have got the best rating, who are being paid in the fourth quartile, are staying back. So, and people who are in the bottom quartiles of the topmost rating are going. So there you understand that among the people I have rated the best, the people who feel that they are not getting paid as much as they used to, or that they deserve, are leaving. Second is, among the people who have rated best, people who have not got awards. So obviously there's an entitlement issue. They've got the best rating, but they've not got any awards. So therefore they're dissatisfied and they're leaving. Second is promotion. People who've not got the best rating but have not got promoted are leaving. So if you cut it by, if you just keep drilling into the data, and you find that you'll find that where is the problem localized, and the interaction of which variables is the problem localized, and therefore this enables you to take action. This you can't take action. Everybody seems to be leaving, it's like, you know, just run. This enables you to take action. And the last what helps is, if you do some simple word clouds around exit interviews that you've conducted, you will find nuggets of information that are never there in your hypothesis. You would have, most people, you know, if you thought that they're leaving because of the money, they would not have left. They would have said, I'm leaving because I'm relocating. I'm leaving because of my manager. So my point being, some of them could be very obvious hypotheses in your mind, but this will enable you to get things about some things that you never even knew. So this is the last slide. Basically, it's an idea of what we are trying to build for companies, which is we want HR to be a data-driven organization, like every other function. And therefore, I think the lift that it gives, more than top line and the bottom line, is more fundamental. I believe it will give you better people, I believe it will give you more engaged people, and you will have the satisfaction of having done the best with the last available rupee or dollar that you had to spend. That's it. Thank you. Precisely. See, if you see this, who has gone out of the organization, I can't do anything.
Right.
You've left.
Right.
So what I'm trying to say is, over here, the green and the reds capture attrition proportions. In the sense, a block, which is the top rating people, the attrition proportion over there is much higher than average.
It's better if we identify them before they get to that stage.
Absolutely. So now I know that people who got the best rating and were not getting paid so well are the people who are leaving. So I'll find others who are like that in my group and do something about it. So that is precisely what you raise, is precisely the objective of this exercise, which is, if I find groups within my organization where attrition is happening more than average, I can capture other people like that and address that problem.
No.
So exit interviews are for people who've left.
Right.
So obviously, from the beginning of time, people would have left, right? There's nothing that you can do about them. But if you had an exit interview process, and you just captured data and just kept it in a file, that's not going to help. All I'm saying is, if you have that information with you, and if you mine that information, it will tell you why people are leaving. That is going to stop you from, stop, or it will enable you to stop people like them to leave. So the attrition problem is always managed with people that you, that were still there. It's never managed with people who left.
I get that, but what I'm saying is, if there was a way of identifying them, I mean, is there something like people have done polls or some kind of...
So, yes, absolutely. So this one, it's not just an exit interview. It could be an employee satisfaction survey. And these two things are not at the same time. This you can do at any time. I'm not saying this and this has to happen. I'm saying this you can do any time. You can just take the data that you have and start analyzing it tomorrow and start seeing where people have left. The main foundation for this is you should have captured this data when they left. Because typically the answers that you get is, oh, the data lies somewhere, or who knows where it is. So I'm saying the, it's a waste because you captured it and you're not using it to solve your own problem. See, which is where, so this is not, got nothing to do with what the employee is feeling right now. This is just behavioral data that you can capture from data that you have. And it is not, so even if no high performer is telling you that he's getting poorly paid, this one will tell you that there is a problem. Right? So you don't need to depend on anybody. Here, exit interviews, if you think about them, are easier than employee engagement surveys. Because if the guy has already decided to leave, if you put him in a comfortable position where you're not trying to pressurize him too much, he may give you more useful data now that he's decided to leave than employment engagement survey. The employment engagement survey, also there are better ways of doing it, where you make sure that you communicate and you stay true to the fact that you're not tracking them individually. If you make sure that you don't capture data individually, you're only capturing it summarized. And if it's amply clear by the process that you're employing that nobody in the organization is going to know that me, Karthik said so-and-so is bad, then it's fine. I mean, it's also got to do with the culture that you built upfront. So if you built a police state kind of culture, then you're dead. I mean, you, first chance people are going to get, you're going to leave. Fine, I'm glad that somebody is there, the audience that I...
No, I mean, I'm attached there, but I work with an HR team, and I work for a company which has 238,000 people on its rolls. So whenever I go and propose to my, I mean, it was 2 months back when I went to my HR head and I said, let's tackle the attrition problem. We were not able to do the segmentation thing very easily, because we understood that there's no single model for predicting the attrition for the entire company. That is simply not possible.
Absolutely.
So what segment should we do? I mean, should it be based on grade? Should it be based on country? Should it be based on your life?
Yeah, so my advice would be start with the things that you think are different. For example, if you have 238,000 employees spread across, say, 9 countries or so, start with segments that you think are different. For example, you would know that an analyst is different from Navy, right? So split them by band. You would know that Romania is pretty different from India, so you split them by country. Start with that, and then go into the other segments that you have data. Because the first ones are usually the ones that you know I have to cut them, and then when you combine them with the other things that you have with you, but you don't have any upfront hypothesis on, that is when the story gets interesting, and you will find things that you never thought existed.
The payslip would get printed more, and the certain in the company log, you'll know the I mean, how many times they are accessing
the that's interesting, right? So, but the thing that I tried to do here was not predict attrition. I think attrition prediction is a more involved science, which is pretty interesting in itself. Here I'm just doing a post hoc analysis to see, can I keep people back? So that is your in attrition prediction, you're trying to be prepared for how many I should hire to backfill the people who left.
Definitely this data would get in there.
Yeah, absolutely.
And one more problem we found with the exit interview is more or less like only, I mean, the real reason is hidden when they say relocation or compensation, but the most often, I mean, compensation would not be the primary reason. It's because the person has had problem with the manager who would have left.
See, that's what I'm saying. So most people, depending on the culture that you've built, would think that I should not tell them the organization I'm going to, or I should not tell them that the manager is a problem because he's going to get me, or he's going to write to my new company. So it's also a culture thing. I think it also starts with, if you convey the fact to the employees that you're genuinely trying to do something about a problem, I think that is when you will get good information over there. And as, like I said, exit interview is probably the last hope because he has, I would think, some of them at least would think of being open because they've decided to leave. But obviously there are people who wouldn't come out even then, and then this angle would help you.
Do you think psychometric data or information helps, or have you used psychometric data to enhance or pull out better insights?
No, so I have not used psychometric data to begin with because my first premise was, let me see, the thing is, the first, especially if you are going into a client organization and saying, do these XYZ things before I start doing something, they say, why don't you go out, right?
After the process.
So what I, my first premise was, what all can I do with data that they already have sitting in there, right? If they have done some, so for example, some of them have these leadership development programs, some of them have these, you know, training programs where they would have collected psychometric data, and if that is there, it will help. But these, what I worked with were typically things that everybody has. And therefore, I thought, let me start with this, but what you're saying is fairly interesting, because then you can bring in the psychological angle of how they are feeling to what the data is saying, and that's pretty interesting. Because then you can start correlate between what they're feeling and what has happened, and whether, you know, there's a linkage, or if there's, they are behaving in a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde kind of way, where they're saying something and doing something else, etc. So that we will certainly, I think social media that somebody talked about is pretty interesting. You can see what people who've gone out are saying in social media, try to mine that information, correlate that with what's happened here. So those are interesting things that we are thinking of doing for the subsequent assignments.
Sorry to interrupt, the closing and feedback session is always starting not very much. So please.
All right, we'll take one more. Yes. You do have this data, right? Even if he's a fresher. You have these, right? Even if he's a fresher, you will certainly have these. So I'm saying you will need more information. For example, I would love to have what is their overall work experience, what is the company that they were before. So that's all more better information. The first thing I started to work with, this is something that everybody will have, and therefore what can I do with this? So if you, this itself, if you just slot them into a matrix and start doing a linkage matrix wise as to who works for what role, you will find that some of your assumptions don't work. For example, we found that in a large bank's back office, the master of arts is doing, on all these parameters, they're doing much better than a CA or a commerce graduate. Why? Because they are happy that they got this role. It's something new and interesting for them, and therefore, you know, they are performing better. This is something that you will never start off believing, right? That is what these things can help you. It's very simple analysis that can help you get these insights. Thank you.